Now, we've seen the Biden administration being consistent, to say the least, when it comes to America's support of Israel in its war against Hamas. What sort of Middle East policy would we see under a Kamala Harris administration? The vice president gave us an insight after her meeting with Benjamin Netanyahu. She told the Israeli prime minister the war must come to an end and vowed to not be silent about suffering in Gaza. And in what CNN called a notable moment, Harris concluded her remarks by telling reporters that the war in Gaza is not a binary issue.
It is important for the American people to remember the war in Gaza is not a binary issue. However, too often the conversation is binary, when the reality is anything but. So I ask my fellow Americans to help encourage efforts to acknowledge the complexity, the nuance, and the history of the region. Let us all condemn terrorism and violence. Let us all do what we can to prevent the suffering of innocent civilians, and let us condemn anti-Semitism, Islamophobia, and hate of any kind.
Douglas, what do you make of those comments?
I mean, it's, well, I mean, it's, first of all, of course, it's tip-top advice from Vice President Harris, isn't it? She said to Benjamin Netanyahu that the war should end. I'm sure that's absolutely fresh to him. He must be surprised that's never occurred to him or anyone in his government. Everybody wants the war to end. But, you know, what is Kamala's plan to get back the hostages, including the American hostages that are held by Hamas and other Islamic militants in Gaza? What's her plan to get them back? She's weirdly silent about it. What is her great expertise in warfare? Or indeed in anything much, to start lecturing an ally that is at war with an enemy that wishes to annihilate it. It's astonishing to me. I mean, if she wants to stop the killing, what's Kamala Harris's plan for stopping Hezbollah launching rockets into Israel like the one this week that killed more than 10 incredible young children, Druze children, from the extraordinary Druze community in Israel? What's her plan to stop Hezbollah rocketing Israeli children when they're playing in a field in northern Israel? What's her plan? I mean, I'd love to know. The truth is, I don't think she knows. One of the things, by the way, you can also always tell when somebody really hasn't studied any complex issue is saying banalities like this is not a binary issue. Actually, parts of this are very binary. You're either with Israel or you're with Hamas. You either want Hamas to be defeated or you want Israel to be defeated. You either want the hostages to be returned and Hamas to be destroyed, or you want the Israelis to fail in their war aims. And so, no, sorry, that is binary. And if Kamala Harris doesn't think it is, perhaps she could look to her supporters, including the ones who were obviously enormously energized by her decision to skip the Netanyahu speech, the joint sessions of Congress, in order to fulfill a very important sorority speaking engagement on the other side of the country. The people who took enormous courage from her stance and thought that history was behind them by turning out on the streets of DC, as I saw with my own eyes, shouting horrible slurs at, among others, black policemen who were doing their best to guard the Capitol that day and shouting white supremacists at them, and then marching through Washington, D.C., calling for the annihilation of Israel and the annihilation of the United States of America. These people were burning the American flag on the streets of Washington, D.C. So actually, that is kind of binary. Are you with the flag burners or against them? I know where I stand. I wish that Kamala Harris made it clearer where she did.
Now, Kamala, as you mentioned, wasn't there, but you were there as Benjamin Netanyahu delivered his speech to the United States Congress. You were sitting there next to Elon Musk, right behind Noah Agamin, who was rescued in June after being abducted by Hamas on October 7. Did you have a chance to speak with her? And also tell me about why Elon Musk was there.
Both Elon Musk and I were invited as guests of the Prime Minister, and it was my enormous honor to sit there among the some of the hostage families, people still waiting for their loved ones to be returned, among families who have lost loved ones in Gaza, people who have had their relatives kidnapped and killed in Gaza, and also, of course, the remarkable Noah. Yes, both Elon and I got a chance to speak with her. It was enormously powerful. I mean, here was a young, beautiful young woman abducted from the Nova Music Festival, had obviously lost many of her friends, had been held for months in the most appalling circumstances, and was only released not through any act of nature or desire of and call of Kamala Harris or anyone else, but by brave members of the IDF who went into Gaza on an extraordinary rescue mission to rescue her and three other hostages some weeks back. And of course, a member of the IDF was killed in that rescue operation. She's a remarkable young woman. And, you know, it's just when we first saw that footage of her being taken away in absolute terror on the back of a motorcycle, I think many people fear they wouldn't see her again, but, you know, she's a remarkable young woman, and she's back with her family and back with her loved ones. And I hope that happens for all the other hostages who are still being held and who the world seems to have forgotten about.